Good morning. Can you hear me over there? Okay, yes. Oh, excellent. So, welcome to the MAGIC specialized course on the Heisenberg group. So, reason why I wish to present such a course is given by the following quote from Roger Hove. So what typically we are able in mathematics to obtain, he spoke about analysis, but I think it's even more general statement, what we can obtain quite a lot of things by some direct calculation or certain explicit technique. But if we will employ Heisenberg group, then we can obtain much more structure and may obtain much more insight into what's going on in different areas. So this is analysis, it's maybe even number theory, and very clearly it's connected to the quantum mechanics. So indeed, Heisenberg group joined together with areas which may initially looks to be quite separated through the certain common structure. And what we will do in our course, we will consider the Heisenberg group and certain material which probably may be known to you. So the purpose of this course is not to introduce many new facts and new theorems, but rather to offer a new fresh look on these theorems. In particular, for example, the Fourier transform, which is something which we start to teach from the first undergraduate courses, that can be viewed just as a certain intertwining operator between two representation, equivalent representation of the Heisenberg group. And the role of Fourier transform in solution of pseudo-differential operators or maybe in some other problems clearly follow from that meaning of Fourier transform as intertwining operators. Again, to highlight connection between different areas, we may note what analysis is built around the operation of derivative. And also, we want an operator of multiplication by x, for example, to build the Taylor expansion of a certain function. We use derivative to find coefficients in the Taylor expansion. And when multiplying by x, we get out monomials which form the Taylor expansion itself. That two operators come together in that very classical tool of analysis. But these two operators may be viewed as mathematical model for the momentum and coordinate operators in quantum mechanics. So derivative and multiplication by x satisfy to the same commutation relation, which are known as Heisenberg commutation relation in quantum mechanics. So that means what when you are doing analysis, there are something to follow in quantum mechanics and vice versa. Studying quantum mechanics, you need to make certain advances in analysis. So we will proceed with step-by-step introduction of corresponding notions. Again, I would like to first to explain connection to other MAGIC courses. Heisenberg group itself is, of course, the nilpotent Lie group. And so what would be presented in this course about Heisenberg group can be viewed as an illustration or as a particular example worked out in details for the general course about Lie groups and Lie algebras. So if you attend that second course before or this year, so you may benefit from that more general point of view on the Heisenberg group from the point of view of Lie group theory. But if you don't attend that course or don't have time to study that general theory, despite of its usefulness and significance, Nevertheless, you may just proceed with our course without that general knowledge, because results about the nilpotent Lie groups and Lie groups in general, which we will be using in our case, may be substituted, general results may be just substituted by certain plane calculation, plane formulas, which not very difficult to verify. And I will always highlight what it may be just a consequence of certain general statement for the nilpotent Lie group or just Lie group, what we are using here, but that not strictly required for understanding what's going on with Heisenberg group. So it's again, purpose of this course is rather to offer certain connections, certain new relations between known facts, rather than building a lot of new information, providing new information and building a huge general abstract theory. And to start with, we will consider just two vectors in n-dimensional complex space, Z and WU, and we introduce the usual inner product in such space. So it's given by component-wise multiplication of Z by the complex conjugation of WU. So that again, quite standard thing in consideration of complex valued vector spaces. And what we will observe based on that inner product, or yes, on this inner product, what it may lead to so-called symplectic form. So the first definition in our course will be the symplectic form on two n-dimensional Euclidean space, which is given by identity 2 here. So for two vectors with components x, y, so each of them x and y being n-dimensional Euclidean space vectors, we introduce that form. Of course, out of the definition, immediately we can see what this form is anti-symmetric. If we change an order of primed and unprimed vectors, then form change its sign. Form, of course, is bilinear. So addition and of vectors and scalar multiplication by scalar result in corresponding change of value of the form. Again, not difficult to verify, just out of the definition. So in connection with the product of complex numbers, in a product of complex numbers, we note that that symplectic form is simply minus imaginary part of that complex valued inner product. So it's maybe just a simple a moment of reflection, which you may ask yourself, okay, what will be the real part of that complex valued product? And of course, you will realize very soon what its usual multiplication of vectors in two-dimensional Euclidean space, usual inner product. So in this sense, complex inner product, which was given on previous slides, So complex inner product given by formula one is in fact combine itself two important products. So a real part of this product is just Euclidean product, usual product in Euclidean space. And the imaginary part of this product is the symplectic form. So complex number really encode this two important structure. And bearing in mind that symplectic form is key element in definition of Hamilton mechanics, classical Hamilton mechanics, we will turn out what complex number may be related to it. And as we will see in the end of course, complex number as well related, closely related to the quantum mechanics. So essentially, complex number became the key element in the construction of these two mechanics, both classical and quantum one. Again, we are oftenly may specialize our consideration of n-dimensional Heisenberg group just to two dimensions. So, to one dimension really, but that will involve two-dimensional vectors. So for this reason, it's worth to note what the symplectic form on two-dimensional vectors is simply given by determinant of corresponding matrix. So if I construct, as indicated in second item, 2 × 2 matrix out of coordinates of two-dimensional vectors, when determinant is exactly its symmetric form. So geometrically, we may conclude what symplectic form for two vectors vanish if vectors are collinear. So usually Euclidean product of two vectors vanish for orthogonal vectors, symplectic form vanish for collinear vectors. Next element of the presentation would be symmetry of the symplectic form. So again, it's easier to verify what happened in two-dimensional case. In two-dimensional case, the symplectic form is preserved by group SL2R. So this is a group of 2 × 2 matrices with real entries and determinant equal to 1. That group really very important in our consideration of the Heisenberg group, and we will meet it several times on several occasions in our course. It will not be our central object to study, so I am considering SL2R in the major course which I am reading any other years with the Heisenberg group course, but where really these two groups were separated in my courses formally, in practically they come out one through another. So now we may introduce what is Heisenberg group. So Heisenberg group with parameter n, so we will call it dimensionality of the Heisenberg group, is essentially the collection of 2n plus 1 real numbers. This is can be parameterized by 2n plus 1 real numbers. And if we introduce these coordinates as a real parameter s and two n-dimensional real vectors x and y, then group law can be written by the identity 4, which involve the symplectic form. So essentially, again, if we will analyze the structure of the group law, you may see what vector components x and y are simply added. So we add them as vectors in corresponding n-dimensional spaces. And then to the scalar part s, we count the corresponding symplectic form of these vectors. So out of this definition, we can immediately see what a Heisenberg group is a non-commutative one, and that follows from antisymmetry of the symplectic form if we change order of primed and unprimed vectors here in group law multiplication. Then we simply have an opposite sign in front the symplectic form. So it's easy to verify, again, it may be done as a direct check, that provided formula defines certain group law, group where the neutral element is provided by a vector with all components equal to zero, and the opposite element is just opposite vector. All components need to change sign. So neutral element and opposite elements look very simple here. If our group is, although our group is non-commutative, there is an important center here. There are collection of elements which has scalar part, arbitrary scalar part S and zero vector part, which commute with any other element. It's again follow easily follow from the group multiplication. Finally, because the group law is given simply by second order polynomial in term of these coordinates, it's easy to verify what given group law is continuous. If we will cube the Heisenberg group with the topology, usual Euclidean topology of two n plus one dimensional Euclidean space, in this topology our group law is continuous. So our group is a particular example of a continuous Lie group. Now we may present, we may want to have some different formulas which define the same group law on our set of Heisenberg group. Well, sometimes just to simplify things, I will switch from n-dimensional to one-dimensional Heisenberg group. Essentially, a lot of in the theory, which is easier to demonstrate with one dimension, still hold with n dimensions, just require a bit of extra notation, not new ideas, really. So, using the complex number, the group law in one dimensions can be represented by means of previous complex valued inner product between complex numbers, as given on the first displayed formula now on the screen. So we again replace two vectors, n-dimensional real vectors x and y, by single complex valued vector z, n-dimensional, and then symplectic form replaced by imaginary part of corresponding inner product. Else, we may introduce so-called polarized form of the Heisenberg group instead of full symplectic form in this place. We just put a product x, y prime, so it's like look like just a half of the symplectic form, one half of symplectic form, but there is group homomorphism we between two representations. So here is a formula for at the end of slide. There is a formula for homomorphism which map the group with law given by equation 6 to the Heisenberg group as was defined at the beginning. So it's easy to demonstrate what this is really this different form of the same group. Else, again, this is a kind of general theory what a general Lie group can be presented as certain subgroup of the matrix group, group of matrix of under multiplication. And here come explicit formula for the Heisenberg group of this this general result. Indeed, taking a map phi from the Heisenberg group to such 3×3 matrices, we will see what multiplication of two such matrices of such form will lead practically to the group operation on the Heisenberg group. So this is again group homomorphism from Heisenberg group to the GL3. And again, it's an easy exercise, expand all three previous expressions, different form for the Heisenberg group, to arbitrary n-dimensional Heisenberg group. So it was presented just in one-dimensional case, to n-dimensional case it can be expanded straightforwardly. Well, again, in analysis we usually benefit from linearizing thing. So instead of considering a complicated function, we take a differential, which is linear approximation to function at given point. And that is very general technique, which came through entire body of mathematics. In particular, for continuous group, the technique of linearization lead from Lie group to Lie algebras. So we having a Lie, a general Lie group, we oftenly want to express its properties on infinitesimal level. On this infinitesimal level, a lot of complicated formula get just linear expression and easier to understand. So connection, again, it's a part of the general theory that a connection between Lie group and Lie algebra may be constructed in different ways. Three of them are listed here. For example, we having a continuous group, we may consider the collection of all one-dimensional continuous subgroups with equivalence relation up to parameterization, up to the speed of moving along that one-dimensional subgroup. Any such continuous one-dimensional subgroup is generated by a certain operator. It's called generator of that one-dimensional subgroup, and elements, generators of these subgroups are elements of Lie algebras. Other way to consider Lie algebra is just to think about it as a tangent space to our group at the identity element. In general, Lie group may be formed as certain manifolds, and that manifold has a different, in sense of differential geometry, is equipped with a tangent space at every point. So if we will take the tangent vector to this manifold at the identity, then operation, say, of conjugation on the Lie group will lead to certain transformation of that tangent space, because conjugation leave identity element in place, when the corresponding differential of this map of conjugation will lead to certain linear operator on the certain linear operator on the tangent space. So that tangent space can be again identified with the Lie algebra of our group. And another way, another way to represent Lie algebras, more related with partial differential equation, is to consider first order vector fields on our group. And then among all these first order vector fields, we single out vector fields which are invariant under group shift. Because our group is non-commutative, the left shift on this group and the right shift on the group provide different operations. So you may have some first order differential operators which are invariant under left shift, and another operator will be invariant under right shift. But they are isomorphic. There is the canonical map for any non-commutative group, which map left shift to the right shift. So it's just given by inversion on the group. So this is the three general ways to construct Lie algebra out of the Lie group. And all of them has their certain significance, certain useful application. So it's useful not to be limited just to one representation for the Lie algebra, but better consider all three of them. And so we are going to discuss all three of them for the Heisenberg group explicitly. So again, skipping the general theory, not relying on the general theory of Lie group, which you may not know, we simply explicitly define what's happened for the Heisenberg group. So to define the first approach based on the semigroup, one-dimensional continuous semigroups, we introduce the operator-valued exponential function as simply the Taylor expansion of corresponding exponent known is from the usual calculus. So here we form a Taylor series, infinite series for exponent, and instead of variable x, real valued usually in calculus, we substitute an arbitrary operator. So if, for example, our operators are bounded, when powers, so operator X capital is bounded, when powers of that operator X is also bounded, when we may define the convergence of this operator for a generic, for any general value of T, and when that expression has a well-defined meaning in certain Banach spaces, so in Banach algebras. So for consideration we of corresponding Lie algebras, we are going to use again different form of the Heisenberg group as matrices, as complex, as vectors with complex entries, and as vectors with real entries. So all forms has their advantages. So considering the representation of Lie algebra as matrices, we pick up upper triangular matrices. So it's of the form on the equation 8 in the left-hand side. It's upper triangular matrices with zeros on the main diagonal. When building the exponent of such matrix, just using usual operational matrices, multiplication and addition, it's an exercise to verify what exponent of such matrix became the matrix in the right-hand side. And this is just came from the fact that our matrices are nilpotent, so any power above of 2 for such matrix is zero matrix. So instead of infinite expansion for the exponent, instead of infinite Taylor series, we simply have second order polynomial, quadratic polynomial of these matrices. So that greatly simplify and really remove topological considerations. So as since we don't have a series, we have polynomial, we don't need to discuss in which sense we are taking sum. And that make things easier for us. When it's particularly, again, from general theory, we see that Lie algebra of the Heisenberg group is three-dimensional vector space. It's always certain vector space. In our case, it's three-dimensional. And as basis of this three-dimensional vector space, we are picking up three vectors S, X, and Y capital, which are shown in equation 9. So again, for these particular vectors, you may see what will be their exponentiated form. So if we exponentiate that vectors, we simply have component X, Y, and S on the Heisenberg group. Taking exponent according to formula 8, we simply get representation in our component representation of the Heisenberg group. Then, again, coming back to one-parameter subgroups, so they are subset of our group, which is parameterized by positive, which parameterized by real numbers and satisfy group property with respect to addition of real numbers. So for one parameter subgroup, we have the group property shown on the first displayed equation. And then since this is a function of a variable t, we may differentiate that function with respect to this variable t and take the value of derivative at the origin, at the identity element of the group. So this is the standard construction, how we build an element of the Lie algebra out of the Lie group. So you take Lie group, take one parameter subgroup parameterized by real parameter T, differentiate it with respect to T, and make a substitution T equal to zero. That create a vector. On the Heisenberg group, we can also introduce first order differential operators. So this is operators built with different derivative with respect to components x, y, and z in equation 11. Whereas here plus and minus signs, plus need to be taken for left invariant vector fields, and minuses need to be taken for right invariant vector fields. So we have a Heisenberg group, so applying elements of Heisenberg group to itself, we got a shift. So we are shifting around the Heisenberg group. So when such a transformation of the Heisenberg group create corresponding transformation in the tangent spaces, so differential operators are transformed correspondingly to the transformation. It's again come from the general differential geometry, but in our case it's more or less can be verified directly. What if you have such a vector field, then shift by element of the Heisenberg group remain that vector field in place. Next element of the theory is the commutator on the Lie algebra. Again, if you have a Lie algebra, it's a vector space. So, for example, tangent space at the identity, but this is not simply a vector space. It's a vector space with additional structure, which is known as a Lie bracket or commutator. And that commutator in general theory is bilinear, antisymmetric, and shall satisfy to the Jacobi identity. So this is first displayed formula on this slide. So if you have three different elements from the Lie algebra and calculate double commutators, second order commutators with permuted cyclically permuted elements A, B, C, when sum of these three cyclically permuted second order commutator shall be equal to zero. This is necessary, this has come out from the general theory. Again, another it's just another illustration of the fact what partial derivative commutes, really, because Lie algebra come out as a partial derivative calculation. Practically, if we have a representation of our group by means of matrices, if we are using homomorphism into matrix group, and we already have such homomorphism for the Heisenberg group, then for commutator we have an explicit formula which is really a commutator. So that bracket AB is calculated as AB minus BA, because matrix multiplication is non-commutative, two products has different values, so where difference is non-zero. And this is commutator of corresponding vector fields. Again, this is an exercise which can be done directly, that in our before constructed generators of the Lie algebra satisfy to the commutator relation, which is known as Heisenberg commutating relation. We will discuss it later in connection with quantum mechanics, what its physical meaning. So commutator of X and Y generate S, and any two other commutators in the among our generator is equal to zero. So this is not surprising, because S is a generator of one-dimensional subgroup, which is the center of the Heisenberg group. and center commute with the all other elements. So generator of S will commute with generator of any other subgroup. So S commuting with X, S commuting with Y. So among that three basic vectors in the Lie algebra, only with commutator X, Y giving S, only with commutator is non-zero. And more generally, the formula for commutator, because we know what commutator shall be bilinear and anti-symmetric, it's very easy to verify out of this property that if we are having an arbitrary element of Lie algebra, again, according to the general theory, it shall be decomposed over the basis as xy, as in identity 13. So having two such elements, we are calculating where Lie algebra commutator, and then symplectic form came out here. Again, it's maybe not very surprising because group law was defined in terms of symplectic form. So the symplectic form resurrect here from the Lie algebra calculation as well. Furthermore, again, because only non-zero commutator which we have is a commutator S, X, X and Y giving S, whatever you try to build as second order commutator, commutator of commutators, then shall be equal to zero, because commutator of two vectors giving the element from the center and center commute with anything, so any second order commutator vanish. And that is particular case, the simplest possible case after commutative case of so-called nilpotently group. So nilpotently group in the general theory, this is groups where a commutator of certain order vanish. In our case, vanishing commutators are already of second order, so our group is nilpotent step 2 Lie group. There are nilpotent step 3, nilpotent step 4, and so on groups. And in some sense, nilpotent step group somehow, in certain sense, natural generalization of commutative group. Commutative group will be nilpotent step 1 group. And here is we just going in that direction, making our group law more and more non-commutative. Again, if we will take two elements generated by exponent from element A and B in the Lie algebra, and then multiply them, because they are not commuting, we do not have the simple law of exponent. Exponent of A times exponent of B is not equal to exponent A plus B if A and B does not commute. If they commute, we can prove that formula out of the properties of Taylor series straightforwardly. But for non-commuting elements, formula are more complicated. And for general case, it's theory of Lie groups and known as Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula. And it involves commutators of arbitrary order. So to make that expression correct, we need take commutator of arbitrary order. But our commutators all after the second order equal to zero, and that greatly simplify the Baker-Campbell-Hausdorff formula for the Heisenberg group. So for Heisenberg group, we have probably the simplest possible formula after commutative case. For commutative case, in the right-hand side, we will have exponent A plus B. Here we have exponent of A plus B, one half of the commutator of A and B. So this is the map which we will use several times in our course as well. So this formula is quite helpful. Finally, the Lie algebra of the Heisenberg group can be graded as any Lie algebra according to that vanishing order of commutator. So In our case, the grading is very straightforward. So we have V naught, which belong subspace in the Lie algebra. It's one-dimensional subspace, which correspond to the center direction in the center of the group, and V1, which is a complement to V0. So when commutator of V1 with itself give us V0, any vector from V1 commuting with different element from the same subspace produce elements from V0. So this is a grading, which again can be generalized for other nilpotent step N Lie group, but we just have here a very short chain in our case. Probably to finish today's lecture, we study that are the automorphisms of the Heisenberg group. Again, it's quite natural why we need groups. Because symmetry greatly simplify study of any subject. When we have a symmetry, it simplify any subject. Things which are invariant under symmetry is easier to study. Why not use that principle recursively and do not study symmetry of symmetries? So of course there is no restriction to do that. So we would like to know for our group, Heisenberg group, which will be symmetry of quantum and classical mechanics. We want to know what are symmetries of the Heisenberg group itself. And again, out of the law, there is a multiplication law. There is a not very difficult theorem which can be proven. There are essentially four types of automorphisms which appears on the Heisenberg group. First of all, because multiplication, there is, of course, inner automorphism or conjugation. That general result, whenever you have the non-commutative group, a non-commutative group, when operation of conjugation is non-trivial. On commutative group, conjugation is identical map. On a non-commutative group, conjugation is not trivial. So it's always produce certain transformation of the group, which is automorphism of this group. This is a general statement, so maybe not so interesting because it's applicable not to the only to the Heisenberg group, but to any group. What is specific to the Heisenberg group is what its law defined by means of the symplectic form. So transformation which preserves symplectic form will lead to automorphism of the Heisenberg group. So we take symplectomorphism, map A from the linear symplectic group, which transform vector XY. If we will apply such transformation to all elements of the group, then group law will be unchanged because symplectic form will be preserved and our map is linear. So that is a second one. Another law, type of transformation which came from the group law is dilation. So in Euclidean space, when you add vectors and when scaling of vector is preserving addition of vector. If you multiply all vectors by two, then it doesn't matter either you do before addition or after addition. The result will be the same. In a nilpotent Lie group, there is a similar dilation, but it shall be graded according to our decomposition of the Heisenberg group into graded subspaces. We apply a factor R to component XY. When we need to apply factor R squared to where commutator, which is center of the group S, if our group will be nilpotent of higher order, then it will appear term R cube, R to the power 4, and so on, for higher commutators. But in Heisenberg group, they disappear. So scaling dilation is done just by these terms R and R squared in corresponding component. And finally, can be viewed as the addition to the previous scaling type argument. If we replace sine to the opposite in the center of group and swap order of X and Y, we will get again automorphism of the Heisenberg group. That came out just from the anti-symmetry of symplectic form. If we change order of X and Y vectors components, symplectic form change its sign to the opposite, so that lead to inversion as the automorphism. So again, general theorem tell us what any automorphism of the Heisenberg group is just a product of these four automorphism of these four types. Probably this is a good place to finish our first lecture. Are there any questions? All right, thank you very much for coming. Hope to see you next week.